Welcome, the Fairfax County Council of PTAs, the Greater Springfield Chamber of Commerce, lots from there, the voice of Vietnamese Americans, and Zeta Phi Beta Sorority, founded the same year that the League was. These are all nonpartisan and nonprofit entities. Flyers with information about each of these organizations are on the table here in the back. We are here to help you be better informed and ask that you remember this is a civil, orderly discussion. Seriously. We also have some special guests. This being, somebody said it was a political year. I'd like to introduce Arthur Purvis, candidate for the position of chair of the Fairfax County Board of Supervisors, Mr. Purvis. David Bulova, candidate for the 37th House of Delegates. Dave Albo, candidate for the 42nd House of Delegates. Scott Cameron, a candidate for the Soil and Water Conservation Commission. Jerry Peters, for the Soil and Water Conservation Commission. Jim Kirkpatrick is president of the Springfield District Council, and also with the stand up so they can see you. I'm hoping that those who will still be here, you might approach these people at the end if you have any further questions or would like to contact them to give them money.
Why don't you go to our website?
And if we start that, I'm gonna get in line too for the turning point. Jim, I'm sorry, is there any other political candidate whom I missed? A very special thank you to Jim Southworth. He follows the League around and takes such good care of us. He represents Fairfax Public Access Television, and you can only imagine what the League of Women Voters puts him through for months at a time. The League and our co-sponsors would like to thank candidates for taking this opportunity to engage the voters. The candidate brochures are available in the back as well. We express our appreciation to the staff at Springfield District Council and the West Springfield Governmental Center for their assistance in providing this venue and helping to set up. And especially thank you for all the volunteers from the League who've been here much of the afternoon. We also thank all of you for having the civic awareness and dedication to attend an event like this. And we hope that you will take the information that you learned this evening and spread it about in your families and in your neighborhoods. There are copies of the League's 2015 What's on the Ballot and Facts for Voters and Vote 411 cards on your seats. I particularly urge you to experiment with the Vote 411 and you will quickly become an aficionado. It is a fabulous piece of technology that will really help your civic awareness. The 2015 voter guides will be published in the Fairfax Times in October and can be accessed at vote411.org. Please see a volunteer if you wish to register or to vote or to pick up an absentee ballot form. I'd like to have the Board of Elections introduce their representatives tonight who are here to register you if you need them.
Hello, I'm Jean Carroll from the Office of Elections and I am a recruiter for election officers. So on your way out.
Pauline Gerhard, delighted to be here, thank you. Thank you.
Kathleen, just one quick question. Did everybody hear okay?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Good.
Sorry, I forgot to ask that. This is the format for our forum tonight. Everyone whose name appears on the ballot was invited to participate. Any candidate who could not appear was asked to send, invited to send a proxy. If there is not a candidate present to whom to address a question, then that question will not be asked, of course. All questions should be brief and specific and indicate whether the question is for Ms. Foley for supervisor or Ms. Schultz for the school board, or for both. Only one question per index card, please. We want to cover a variety of topics. And at the end, we have a period of time set aside so that you can speak directly with the candidates, ask the questions that you thought of later, and get a chance to hear a little bit more in person about their programs. And we will take a little break in about an hour so that Mr. Southworth can change the tape on his recording machine. The candidates have agreed in writing to these rules prior to beginning. I'd like to introduce Corazon Foley, candidate for supervisor in Springfield District, and Elizabeth Schultz, candidate for school board, Fairfax District. Each candidate will have 3 minutes for an opening statement. We have timers sitting in the front seat. At 30 seconds, they will hold up that, and when you see that, you don't finish the sentence. So we will begin, and I'm going to take the privilege accorded me as moderator to ask a question of both of you. Let me just get my piles of questions here. The 2017 school budget has $135 million short. Mea maxima culpa, maxima. I'm so sorry, I got carried away with myself.
Thank you for this opportunity to do what the League of Women Voters has always advocated, make accountable our elected officials. I believe the Springfield supervisor should provide leadership, integrity, community engagement, and fairness. Fairness in seeking more state and federal funding for our roads and schools, as well as fair share for Springfield senior health programs. It is time for a change, for more mature and dedicated leadership. Working as a part-timer, the incumbent has not been doing his job of providing constituent service, particularly for more mature seniors like me. He failed to work with us on solutions to redress the unfairness, with other districts having 17 permanent senior centers, while Springfield District, none. Over the last 8 years, I founded and developed the public-private Senior Center Without Walls, with cost-effective health programs recognized with national, state, local awards, including Community Champion and Lady Fairfax. We got 1,000 signatures for our petition for fairer share of county resources, but he ignored our requests for a working group to implement solutions. So I ask you to vote for me, Corazon Foley, as your full-time Springfield supervisor. I have the education, an MBA in finance, and public service experience, 30 years with the US State Department. I am not beholden to political contributors, for I am an independent candidate with no fundraising, spending $1,000 of my own money. He has raised over $400,000, and by May 2015 had spent some $300,000, demonstrating that he is a big spender of other people's money. Like his constituents, he opposed a 27% pay raise for full-time supervisor work. But If he does not work full-time, he is not qualified for the job. And if he is reelected and remains a part-timer, he should return the $20,000 annual pay raise that he would not deserve. I will cut wasteful spending, starting with the $500,000 budget of the Springfield supervisor. He is the biggest spender among the supervisors, spending 41% more than the Providence supervisor. Thank you.
Do I have to come over to the podium? Okay. I'm not. I'm just going to stand over here. So thank you all, first of all, for coming. Thank you to the League and to the American Association of University Women, not just because I was one at some point, not too long ago, right? I want to welcome you all to a discussion about some very serious issues that are coming on the horizon for Fairfax County. Many people don't know and don't understand the imperative nature of paying attention not to just board of supervisors, and with due reference to our other candidates here for people who go down to Richmond, but 53% or more of the Fairfax County budget is spent by the Fairfax County School Board. That means 53% of your property taxes, 53% of the local taxes, and frankly, many of my colleagues on the school board and their compatriots on the Board of Supervisors are looking to levy even more taxes in Fairfax County in the form of meals tax, which make it more difficult for many to live and retire in place in Fairfax County, which I think is a very serious problem. As we head into a Fairfax County budget, which is incredibly challenging, I think the biggest part of the challenge is that the school board itself has not done its homework. We come annually for what I say every 300 years is the duke out on Main Street with the Board of Supervisors, and it becomes a very public battle over your money for more than 70% of our funding. Very little of Fairfax County Public Schools funding comes from the federal government, only about $42 million, and some comes from the state. We do have some challenges in Fairfax County in the terms of growth of our student population. Our incoming kindergarten class is about 35% ESOL, English as a second language student. There are challenges, but most of the challenges are self-made with a lack of vision and a lack of good common sense leadership by many of my colleagues on the school board. So it's imperative to me this election cycle to make sure that not just the parents of children in the school system, and only 25% of residents of Fairfax County actually have students currently in the public school system, but that the 75% understand that your investment in the public school system has to be paid attention to. It is your home values, it is jobs, it is the ability to retire in place. And so that's very important that you understand you can vote Chicago style for your magisterial district candidate, and then you vote, 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 and vote again because you get to vote for three at large. So that's imperative to me to do voter education as well. Thank you to the League of Women Voters.
I know, as I was saying, given the problems that you all have begun to outline, this is a question, by the way, for both of you. You will have 1 minute to answer. What is your perception of the current working relationship between the school board and the Board of Supervisors, and what could you do to make it more effective? And this time with Ms. Schultz.
I'm following the rules on green. Green means go. My perception of the relationship with this Board of Supervisors, well, I'm an incumbent, and even as an incumbent, I can tell you it's not great. And it's not great because I think that there's a culture within the school board of an entitlement to your taxpayer dollars. And I think that it becomes necessary for us as a school board to set the priorities on where the money goes so that we drive the majority of your education tax dollars into classrooms. And if we start to focus on the priorities in-house first, I think we're going to demonstrably improve our relationship with board supervisors.
Well, my feeling on this is that the school board has 52%, or the school system has 52% of our budget. I think we really need to get an auditor. I think that's what the board of supervisors has suggested. There are a lot of questions about the spending of the school board. I have a question myself about the special education program. My daughter is a special education teacher. I think that if you compare Montgomery County and Fairfax County, you will see that special education costs in Fairfax County are much higher and have been rising. And I think the school board and the school system has a responsibility to check those drivers of cost and make sure that they are managed better.
Thank you, Ms. Foley. And here's this round question first to Ms. Foley. Why did you decide to run for supervisor of this district?
I believe the supervisor has a responsibility to his employers, including me. I'm an employer, as long as I'm not elected. I think he has to be engaged with the community. If the community has a specific issue that will improve the quality of our lives, he should respond. We were able to meet with him in November because the press asked him to do so. He went with us, he gave great words, good words about our work for the press. But then when we asked to meet with him again to have a working group to address the issues, the fact that we need fairer share of county resources as seniors here in Springfield District, he has refused to respond.
Thank you, Ms. Foley. Ms. Schultz, what do you see as the single biggest issue facing the school board this year?
I think that the single biggest issue that we're facing is one that we're actually not tackling, which is the nexus of the facilities crisis on the horizon. We have an ever-increasing student population that the school board in the past has not planned for and has not demanded accountability from the staff in terms of accuracy of the projections. And so now our children are going to school in 1,000 trailers across the county. And the numbers aren't decreasing. And so there's no capital plan in the strategic plan that the school board just passed, which is why I didn't vote for the strategic plan. Because when you have 27 million square feet of capital infrastructure that's your capital infrastructure that's taxpayer funded, and you don't have enough space for the children and there's more children coming, you have a very big crisis on the horizon, and it's something that I've been trying to ring a bell about for quite some time. So I think it's very important for a strategic vision to start on how you handle and maintain taxpayer facilities so that you take care of the taxpayer investments and provide an education for children that isn't a trailer education in Fairfax County.
Thank you. Hold the microphone because we'll start with you on this round. What are your thoughts about the appropriate balance of investing in magnet schools such as Thomas Jefferson versus ensuring that all schools have the resources so that students can excel?
Well, if we're talking about the renovation of Thomas Jefferson, I actually was the one who led the fight to have the surrounding jurisdictions pay their portion of the renovation because they send students to our TJ, which happens to be in our district. And the school board and the previous superintendent had planned on having the $90 million for the renovation of TJ footed completely by the Fairfax County taxpayers, which I found outrageous. So I pushed for the burdening of the other taxpayers in other jurisdictions. For me, having all kids, regardless of if they're regular kids or gifted kids or special education kids, in good facilities with good curriculum that's rigor intensive and leads to student achievement is paramount.
Thank you.
I'm reminded of something my husband always says. We live in Fairfax County.
I haven't asked the question.
Oh, I'm sorry, I was answering that question.
If you answer my questions, their questions.
Oh, could I do that? where we live in Fairfield.
May I ask the question?
Oh, I thought you already did about PJ. Oh, I'm sorry.
That was her question. No, I'll indicate at the beginning of the question when it's for both. It's specified by the questioner. Ms. Foley, do you think that we need increased funding for affordable housing in the county as a whole?
Affordable housing. I heard from many people the need for affordable housing. And when they talk about affordable housing, I think we should recognize we're talking about seniors who want to age in place. And therefore, the issue there is rules and regulations to assure that one could have a much better place for them, perhaps as a part of a family in a multi-generational arrangement. The issue of increased funding, well, we can do things, and I think the board has done this, where without cost to the county, we can provide density bonuses so that we can have workforce housing and housing for low income. And we are all compassionate people. I support the program to end homelessness in Fairfax County.
Please keep the mic. Ms. Foley, why is it important that the senior center you propose be physically located in Springfield District when there are other centers available, Braddock, for example, or Kingstown, a short distance away?
We have a very big group of seniors in Springfield District area that need the health programs that we have had to provide in the senior center without walls. And therefore, we have proven the demand for it here in Springfield District. It is only in Springfield District that the supervisor has shown no interest in supporting the growing number of seniors in their needs for health programs. Let me remind you that the longer a senior is healthy and functional, the less the burden on their children, their grandchildren, and the community at large, in this case, on Springfield District.
Ms. Schultz, what would you identify as some issues that are particularly germane to the Springfield District?
Without a shadow of a doubt, it is class size. We are disproportionately affected in the Springfield District with very high class sizes. Out of the 4,053 elementary classrooms in Fairfax County, across the whole county, 1,026 classrooms are 20 and under. 20 and fewer children in 1,026 out of 4,053 elementary classrooms. The predominant number of those classrooms are not in the Springfield District. I have schools where, an elementary school where the smallest classroom in the entire elementary school starts at 25 and they go up from there. So our children are singled out for disproportionately high classes, which affect their teachers, which affect the efficacy of the education, affect all of the fine arts and special classes. It's a very significant burden to those little children on a day-to-day basis.
Thank you. Hold it. No, that's her question. Regarding preschool education, what is your position on having it as the standard option, such as is the situation in New York City?
Well, Fairfax County Public Schools' primary mission is K through 12 education. We are not set up to fund preschool education, and we frankly don't have the facilities. And what I have advocated in the alternative is something that's pro-business and pro-community and pro-authentic engagement, which is start to set up a public-private partnership with all of the private preschools that exist throughout the county that have additional space. And that allows us to buy up some of those spaces where children are present and gives them a quality education that many of us pay regularly for, particularly at risk, and focusing on 4-year-olds at risk because they're going to be in the school system next year, so they have to be prioritized.
Here is a question for both of you. What ideas do you have on closing that $143 million shortfall in the school budget? Specific suggestions.
All right. Well, the first option, the first solution, of course, is to get the state to pay their share. Because we, as everybody here, I suppose, knows, we're not getting our fair share of state resources. I said, I'm asking for a fair share for seniors here, but we also, the schools need their fair share of resources from the state. Also, the federal government should also put, pay up what it needs to pay the school. For example, in special education, they have not been paying about $71 million that they should be paying as part of the agreement for special education. I believe it's in the budget documents.
Well, we're a donor county, so we send 83 cents out of every dollar down to Richmond. So I don't know how we're gonna convince all the other districts to send us more money in the LCI. That would be great, but I don't know that that'll work. We have, again, the need to do the homework in-house as a school board. And what I have advocated is something that the Board of Supervisors does periodically, which is a full line item, zero-based budget review where the school board sits down with every single department within FCPS and rebuilds the budget up from zero. The biggest problem is that whatever last year's ending balance is becomes the successive year's beginning balance, and nobody ever goes back and establishes what the priorities are, what we do well, what we don't do well, why it takes 7 years for children to get through English as a second language class, et cetera. So I think that first doing a line item budget review in-house and the budget being accountable first to the school board because it's the school board's budget, not the superintendent's.
Thank you. Keep the phone. Are they in mic?
I've got it. I'm figuring it out.
What is your position on the new student health curriculum?
If anybody watched any YouTube videos, I am not a fan of allowing the federal government to overreach into 14,000 school boards and 90,000 school board members and threaten to pull federal education funding if we don't employ social experimentation in the classroom through health and family life curriculums. I think the parents are the primary educators of their children, that they have to have their voice first in the education of their children, and that we have to be utterly transparent in the way that we develop policies as a school board and determine the cost of those policies before putting them in place, not after.
Thank you. Ms. Foley, what do you see as the greatest challenge facing the new Board of Supervisors coming in? And what would you do, what would you propose to solve that significant problem?
The budget is the major project for the school board. And we need to go through the lines of business, to make our county government more efficient. I oppose higher taxes. I believe that there is a lot of programs that could be consolidated, and we should definitely pursue efficiencies. We have a county and a country that is facing difficult times. We really shouldn't burden our taxpayers anymore. Particularly for the senior taxpayers, it is very difficult to live here in Fairfax County as it is, and therefore I believe the biggest task for that board is to go through the lines of business review and cut costs.
Ms. Foley, going from macro to micro, what is the single most important issue here in Springfield?
Well, when the supervisor was asked about that last year at George Mason, and I'm sorry he's not here, because he pointed to the age wave as the single most important challenge that has not been addressed in Springfield District. And I think a supervisor should have integrity. When he says that is the problem, then he should work with the seniors to make sure that in fact this is age friendly, and that when we need health programs, he should not be the only one that ignores the issue.
Thank you. Ms. Schultz, please tell us your views on the core standards.
I am not in favor of Common Core. And as we see states across the United States, after they have implemented Common Core, retreating from Common Core, what you're seeing is the lack of efficacy of it. While the concept is good, federalizing your education system has not turned out well. The No Child Left Behind, NCLB, wasn't the right answer, and being able to walk into any classroom in Fairfax County in third grade on the 82nd day of education and into a social studies classroom and make sure that every teacher is teaching the exact same thing on the exact same day takes away innovation from teachers and takes away the ability to adapt to the needs of the children in the classroom. So I think that that's definitely not the right answer for the Commonwealth of Virginia and especially not Fairfax County.
Thank you. Recently, a task force came up with a list of possible budget cuts, programs that could be eliminated. Given that no one wants to see any of them go, if they can help it, which of the possibilities listed on that report do you think could be implemented with the least impact on the education of the students?
None. I think there's no way to, that may be a cheeky answer, but the bottom line is when you get to $100 million budget gap, what's coming is the payment that's long overdue from a lack of leadership, not from 1 year or 4 years, but many, many, many years by some of my colleagues on the school board. And the answer is something's gonna be cut and it's gonna be painful. And I think it's very unfortunate, and this is why it's so important for me to have voters pay attention to the school board, to all four votes that you have to cast, because you get to vote for a third of the school board. And this is an unfortunate time in our budget cycle where it really is gonna hurt this time.
Thank you. Ms. Foley, do you support the widening of Rolling Road to the Parkway?
Yes, I do. I understand that we finally got the funding for it. And the issue, of course, is the impact on the folks that live around the Rolling Road, whether they would have to take their property. I think this is the same kind of issue that came out with I-66. As a person who cherishes our home, the idea of taking somebody's property is not something that is easy. So I think that's something that has to be discussed very carefully with compassion for those around Rolling Road.
Thank you. This round, it's a question for both of you. Since the school budget has a $135 million shortfall, $42 million of that is increased spending for health care and pensions. $72 million is for 4% raises. Would you, A, raise the real estate tax rate, 6 cents, cut programs by $135 million, or reduce raises and benefits?
I'm a supporter. I worked for the federal government for 30 years, and I have the old system. My son has the new system. And I support changing the pension to 401k for the new employees. One shouldn't break contracts, I understand that. So I do understand the need to change the pension plan. Now, as for the raises, I think we have to understand, and I have to make a disclosure here. My daughter is a teacher in Fairfax County Schools. So of course I want to see teacher pay increased. That may be a conflict of interest. But yeah, I would choose very carefully where we would put the raises. Not everybody deserves the raise. Certainly the teachers in the classroom do.
So I'm gonna disagree with those figures a little bit, but that's neither here nor there. The real answer is that the efficacy of the way we staff the school system and where we have staffing and whether the staffing is in the classroom is really the right answer for that. And it's something that frankly was taken off the table for the working group that looked at it. So I have a problem with sometimes it's a question of needs versus wants, and the school board has not been very good at eliminating the wants. Everything is a need, everything is a sacred cow, and we can't take anything off the table. And that's the wrong approach to leadership. Is the right approach is to say that we built up a lot of programs and made a lot of offerings that are not particularly efficient in the use of your education dollars, and we're gonna have to pull back some of those programs, but that affects staff. So that's it's a body cut first on the less efficient programming choices that are the least likely to affect students.
Thank you. Your second question, well, next round. According to the ACT College Admissions Test, only 4% of Fairfax County seniors are adequately prepared for college. Do you agree with that number? Do you find it acceptable?
No, Arthur, I don't agree with it. I think that there's a slice of looking at the preparatory factors for our students. I always think that you can have better informed, better prepared, better strategic thinkers, better writers, better communicators. But at the end of the day, the question is are our students graduating largely because of the amount of assistance that they get from their parents and their extended family, or is it because of what's happening in the classroom? And you know, that's a difficult thing to say, and say that, you know what, we have a very highly educated population that to some degree is really helping their children along. And that's the question is, are we meeting the students' needs or are the parents meeting the students' needs with additional tutors, additional help? And I think that's really the real issue is how much the school system is doing versus how much is being done by the parents.
Thank you. Ms. Foley, are you happy with how the state's increased transportation funds are being spent? What would be your priorities?
Well, it was a great relief for a lot of people, particularly in Fairfax, when Governor McDonald, I guess he's in jail now, but before he went to jail, he certainly gave us a good transportation bill, and I think we should be grateful for that, even though there are some increases in our taxes. But am I happy with that? Yes. The question that I guess would have to deal with how we pay for those improvements in transit that are not covered, because most of the transportation were for congestion relief and not for pedestrian and bike-friendly improvements, which we need.
Thank you. And while you have the mic, do you support the meals tax? Why or why not?
I believe I have it on your website. I oppose the meals tax. I think right now we need budget discipline and economic growth. I do not think that having the meals tax would, as one of the supervisors said, lower our property tax, our real estate tax. I think it will just be another tax that will be used to be added to our cost. So I believe we need budget discipline and economic growth, not a meals tax. And I support the restaurants and the industry that will be highly affected by this.
No, that was one person. Ms. Schultz, what can be done to reassure parents concerned about the new health curriculum?
Not a lot. You know, in May and June, the school board passed policies before any of the regulations to support those policies were written or developed. In addition, we've since learned who the consultant was that was hired by Fairfax County to guide them in best practices, and this individual definitely has vested interest in a certain outcome. And I don't think that's very transparent. At the end of the day, We need to get back to a strategic curriculum that teaches the core of what children need to be successful adults, successful in business, and contributing members of society. And we've gotten way off the beaten path with a lot of time and a lot of effort spent on something that isn't centered around student achievement. And I think there ought to be a lot more concern around minority student achievement than just kind of a student achievement.
Thank you. Is the school board continuing to seek specific change in the state formula for funding?
That's a good question. That's annually in our legislative package. Again, another lack of priority and focus. I believe I counted up the bullets in our legislative package last year, which I did not vote for, and it was something like 184 bullets. And I said, how can you go to Richmond and advocate when you have 184 different line items you're advocating for? Pick three or four or five and go down there and advocate in spades and get the attention of our lawmakers in Richmond. But that's your school board. They want more money. They want more legislation. You know, I had a colleague who wanted to support an equal rights amendment in the U.S. federal constitution. I'm like, what are you? Like, I don't even understand what his role is on the school board. Let's get back to the board doing its job professionally and considerately with authentic engagement with the public and with the board of supervisors and being responsible with your tax money.
Thank you. And the final question for both of you. What is your impression early on? What is your feeling about the recent changes in school schedules? And early on, are there any indicators that you can see?
I do think it's a helpful and healthful change. I actually am a parent that's directly affected. And my children were greatly affected because they went to a secondary school, Robinson, where the children in seventh and eighth grade at our secondary schools had to start on that early high school schedule as young as 12 years old in seventh grade. And so today's only the second day, but I can tell you I've actually had far fewer complaints about transportation in 2 days than I have in all the previous 3 years start. So I think that the school system prepared well for it. And I'm already hearing from teachers that the kids, frankly, like, are happier already. So it's way early to offer, but it's a positive initial outlook.
Ms. Foley.
All right. When I was working, I used to wake up at 5:30 in the morning, so I sort of looked at this change in the schedule and then the fact that it was going to raise the costs, and I was concerned about that. There was also another issue that I think maybe was not thought out well, maybe because I have a teacher in my family. When they cut out the half day Monday, because the teachers were using that period in order to prepare for their classes and do a better job of teaching the students. So I heard from teachers that I know quite well that maybe that was not well thought out. And again, that's a question. If you are faced with incredible large deficits, why are you making all these choices like raising the salaries of the school board members and other unnecessary costs? I mean, that just makes a mockery of what you talk about when you say that you need to cut costs. If you need to cut costs, cut costs.
No, not in this format. That concludes our basket of prepared questions, but we have a couple of minutes left, and if there's someone who came in a bit late or someone who did not have the opportunity to drop a question in the box, then this is your opportunity. Mm-hmm. Sir?
I asked a question.
I'm sorry?
I already had a question.
You may, if there's...
So the great school board controversy was centered around teaching our children that there are four components to sexual identity. My question is, are four components of sexual identity currently being taught in family life education?
Is this question for both?
the auspices are from the superintendent that there are no changes this year to the curriculum and that they're only coming next year. I would posit that something's eventually going to begin to eke its way into the curriculum, and I would caution parents to take full advantage of opt-out, or if they're not opting out, to pay incredibly close attention, because the opt-out forms do not come home with detailed curriculum information. It's just a very surface amount of information, and I would be very leery about what's happening, even though it's purported that nothing will change this year. The fact that they say nothing will change, I think that the primary responsibility lies with the parents. I'll answer questions that anybody wants to ask, for as long as they're willing.
Elizabeth, you gave a good comment. I thought on class size, how important that is. So the question is, dealing with two big classes, oh, I'm sorry.
Dealing with two large class sizes, do you hire more teachers? Is there enough classrooms to add? What have you thought about, or what would you propose to help that very critical situation?
So one of the primary things that I've been focusing on is the fact that 6,000 seats exist just in elementary school, because we reserve the after-school childcare classrooms for after-school. They technically belong to the Fairfax County government, to the Board of Supervisors. But I have schools where a locked, perfectly good classroom sits there all day, or it's only used temporarily to have a child take a test or something, while children across the hall are at 33, 34 in a class. So I think that absolutely the SAC classrooms have to be returned, and there can be a modular system where the after school items are kept locked away for those teachers, but making the wisest use of the resources that we have, and then also elevating a classroom floor. And the problem doesn't just exist within elementary classes, it's in high schools as well, of having a minimum that you have to have. Because if you have 13 or 14 or 15 students in a classroom, you are by default spreading out those staffing costs. So we don't need more teachers. What we need is a wiser attribution of students to the classrooms that we have already in place.
Sir.
Ms. Foley, can you tell us more about the Senior Center Without Walls and why you think that demonstrates exactly the kind of program that you're advocating?
Oh, thank you very much, John, for that question. First of all, let me just tell everybody that the Senior Center Without Walls is the most cost-effective senior center in the county, bar none. Our costs are about 20% of the cost of a regular senior center. How do we do this? We do this by the work of the wonderful citizens around here who volunteer to do the class monitoring for which the county would have paid. We also do it by donations of the churches and the Burke Conservancy, the other private organizations of space. But we also need other space, including, we've used this room, by the way, and I've asked them to take the rug because seniors have fallen, and I couldn't even get that. That's the kind of lack of response that we've been getting.
Thank you. Any other questions? Ma'am.
Oh, good evening. My question is for Ms. Foley. I understand the concept of having a new senior center specifically for seniors. Do you have any creative ways that other segments of the population will benefit from a senior center once it's actually constructed?
Thank you for that, because I did write a letter that was published about a multi-generational vision for our program. You see, I'm a grandmother, and I'm also mother, so I see an addition of a space in Boyk Library as being available not only to the seniors, But to our grandchildren, our children, we will be using the space usually from 10 to 2, sometime in the mornings. And then the rest of the day will be available to the community, to the younger folks and others who would like to use the facility. It's multi-generational. Thank you.
Thank you. Sir.
My question is for Ms. Schultz. As a retired teacher, retired from Fairfax County, but also worked in California as well, for your facility shortfalls, have you considered the option of year-round schooling with rotating populations?
I just yesterday, when my children came home from the first day of school and told me how tired they were and wanted summer back, I said, I'm willing to get rid of your summer. I think that year-round schooling actually would save us a lot of money, because we would not lose a lot of achievement that we get over the summer. And when children don't start back to school till September 8th, I can tell you from personal experience, my children's brains were not prepped for school. So absolutely, I think it solves minority student achievement. I think it solves at-risk achievement. I think it makes a wise use of taxpayer resources. And since I was predominantly responsible for the full day Mondays, which added 80 days over the course of a K through 6 education to an elementary school student, and they do have protected teacher planning time, that's how you get wise with the money, because you are already paying the teachers, so why not have the children in school? And so now we're meeting state mandates. Children are in school, families, especially working families, have a consistent schedule 5 days a week. That's being smart with the taxpayer resources.
We have about 7 or 8 minutes before the tape runs out. That gives us time for one or two more questions.
This is a question for Ms. Schultz. We talked about the school budget and the millions and millions of dollars that we spend, and yet no one talks about, we talk about the students and the needs, and there's no question about that. But I'm curious as to what this ratio of management personnel is to teachers. Is it 3-to-1 managers or teachers, or is it the other way around? There are a lot of people who are salaried at the six-figure levels in this county, and we have multi-layer management levels that I think could be trimmed, but I'd like you to address that.
So if you listen to the school system, they will proclaim that there is a standard formula that they follow, and that we have significantly trimmed back that management ratio. And I think largely that's true. But the question becomes not maybe the people at the top, because you need a superintendent and deputy superintendent, but it is all the layers of program specialists and program managers and program directors that, you know, sooner or later it's spreading in the middle. And the question is how much of that is actually in the classroom. And they're very fond of the term classroom-based. That's not a classroom teacher. And so I find that definitely concerning, but we won't know until we do it. And our current chairman of the school board said during a budget passage that she didn't think it was her responsibility to dig into the line items of the budget. So that's a $3 billion organization that they're in charge of that they've got to pay very, very close attention to, because it is your money.
Thank you, Ms. Schultz. A final question. There is a gentleman whom I'd like to introduce. Mr. Fry, would you stand, please? John Fry is running for clerk of the court. Thank you for coming this evening. This concludes the formal portion of our meet and greet for Springfield District. If you see any candidate who was on the, who will be on the ballot, and you don't see that individual here tonight, tell him or her that you missed him, and remember to vote on November 3rd. Now you'll have the opportunity to speak with the one-on-one with the candidates and ask individual questions.
Did we do a closing statement?
In a more informal way as they mingle with the audience. Thank you for coming.
Do we have a closing statement or
no? Oh. No, there will be no closing statement. I beg your pardon.
Before you leave, your evaluations of tonight's program.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.